Welcome to the New York Society Library. I'm Sarah Holliday, Library Events Coordinator. As we begin, let me make my customary joke about there being no cell phones in the Romantic period. Thank you. Please silence anything that might disrupt the presentation. We appreciate it. I'd also like to mention that your donations to our annual fund support events like this one, as well as the maintenance of our landmark building and the continued growth and strength of our collections for readers of all ages. Donor information is available at the circulation desk or from any staffer, and we appreciate your support. So there's this little musical currently on Broadway that asks the powerful question, who lives, who dies, who tells your story? In the case of Annabella Milbanke, Lady Byron, her story has been told several times, including by Harriet Beecher Stowe, but never with an awareness of her as a real person who made remarkable contributions to the world beyond her husband's entertaining scandals. The time has come, says Julia Markus, to realize that history is also her story. The New York Times adds that Lady Byron and Her Daughters offers an important corrective. Here, Annabella is not merely an unsatisfactory bit player in Byron's glamorous tragedy, but a person in her own right, a woman of intelligence and imagination who made something of her life in the most difficult of circumstances. Beyond doubt is the importance of a book that celebrates a worthy but complex woman who led a big life that is still unsung. The Times concludes, long may such singing as this continue. I can't really say better than that. Julia Markus holds a PhD in Victorian Literature from the University of Maryland. Her four novels include Uncle, winner of the Howard Mifflin Literary Award, and her biographies include Dared and Done, The Marriage of Elizabeth Barrett and Robert Browning, and J.M.P. Froude, The Last Undiscovered Great Victorian. Please join me in welcoming Julia Markus.
The lighting's not too good, obviously, but I can see. Never say never. I had originally planned to write three biographies on the late Victorian period and then go back to fiction. However, after completing these three biographies on Browning, on Froude, and on the women artists of Rome who loved women, by the way, I was delighted to see the Hiram Powers sculptures here because the Brownings were good friends of Hiram Powers. They lived in Rome and Florence together, and there was a whole flock of women sculptors as well. First, Harriet Hosmer was on the cover of my book. Anyway, I thought it was very synchronistic to bump into Hiram Powers tonight. Well, anyway, I was going to go back to fiction. When Lady Byron caught my eye, and before I knew it, I was swept from the Victorian period into the fashionable whirl of the early Regency, where the golden rule appeared to be do whatever you want, but do it discreetly. Annabella Milbanke and Lord Byron's dysfunctional marriage lasted exactly 1 year, 1815, plus 3 days. Yet because of Lord Byron's late poetry, in which he presented himself as a victim of the marital breakup, and because of Lady Byron's silence concerning why she sought and obtained a legal separation from him, because of this, she was evidently eventually viewed as cold and unfeeling the way Byron presented her. He called her his moral Clytemnestra, robbing him not of his life, but of his soul. As the century progressed and his poetry came more and more famous, actually, what he said as a poet was taken as truth. Lady Byron's 20th century biographers went even further, interpreting just about every word in her enormous archives at Oxford to turn her into a caricature, at best a dull-witted woman who couldn't understand the great poet, her husband, at worst a monster, truly a monster devoid of all humanity. These biographers, male and female, seemed to feel they would have made Byron a better wife than she. It reminds me of what Lady Byron said of a letter from Walter Scott when he praised her and then went on to praise Byron so effusively that she said Walter Scott would have had to take Lord Byron for better or worse before his opinion changed. Lady Byron was a minor poet her whole life. On her 60th birthday, she wrote, "O world, I have known thee, and ere my farewell, of thy scorn and thy kindness, I frankly would tell. Thou canst not forget me, embalmed by a name. I must live in the record of honor or blame." At the age of 60, she was considering writing, as her poem indicates, an accurate biography or prose memoir of her marriage. She never succeeded. She just couldn't do it. But one of her failed attempts at a prologue to this unwritten memoir moved me to want me to want to know more. I'll just read it to you. I think it's rather poignant. Lady Byron wrote that she had more realized that at least some of the animus directed towards her came from the fact she never defended herself in public against Lord Byron's brilliant and bitter accounts of her in his later poetry, nor from the critics who continued to degrade her in print. Still, quote, "I have no cause to complain of the world's unkindness. On the contrary, I am grateful for it. In personal intercourse, I have only to acknowledge the kindness and most generous treatment. And if I have sometimes been condemned by strangers without evidence, I have certainly been acquitted equally without proof by those on whom I have no claim. Of the charge of listening to reformers against Lord Byron, sanctioning treacherous practices, etc., there can be no media via to such accusations. The woman who could be guilty of any one of them could not be trustworthy witness to matters relating to the husband she had injured and betrayed. Read then no further, you who hold this sheet in your hands, unless you can relinquish all possessions of that kind. Think of me as a memory, not a person, for I desire no sympathy, but an impartial hearing. When I look at the accumulation of difficulties in my way, I feel that the truths I may bring forward will but partially dispel illusions, so long accepted as realities, and that even if not as fruitless, it is yet an ungraceful task to translate fascinating verse into practical prose and mere fact. Apart, however, from any view to benefit the unknown reader who may have little disposition to attend to me, I naturally desire to leave a few counterstatements for the information of my grandchildren, for I know that on that point, the opinion formed of me does touch me. So she wished to write this memoir for her grandchildren, and a fair one. She never betrayed Lord Byron's trust, but she couldn't do it. But I thought these glimpses into her were fascinating, and I wished to find out who she really was. And is Isabella Noel Byron, always called Annabella? I wanted to place her against the texture of her time, be honest about her failures, and come to an understanding of her temperament in a way that would make us all see her as a human being, flawed, but human. Not the cold blue blood, the moral Clytemnestra her husband turned her into after she refused to return to his control. There are so few injustices in this great world of ours that we have even the slightest chance to address. It felt good to address this one. Never say never. But I knew the minute I made my decision that the challenge of writing the biography was twofold. The first challenge was not to get wrapped up in fascinating Lord Byron and make it all his story again. Yet that period of Annabella Milbanke's life, her promising youth, The courtship, the marriage, the separation is irresistible to a biographer because it has such a natural narrative thrust to it. It moves you forward. Brilliant Annabella Milbanke, unimpressed by the superficial finery of her class, 19 years old, pretty, kind, intellectually gifted, particularly in mathematics, a future heiress to boot. Why, she was sought out by all the eligible Regency males in London in the year 1812. Enter with dramatic lip, handsome, romantic, mad, bad 24-year-old Lord Byron, who had just recently published Childe Harold's Pilgrimage and woke up one morning, as he said, and found himself famous. Suddenly, Regency women were flaunting all over him, and I do think poetry to one side. The rumor that he was extraordinarily, and I mean extraordinarily well endowed, did little to abate their curiosity. Watching these women from a safe distance, young Annabella wrote a poem satirizing their behavior entitled Byron Mania. In it, she asked if human nature were to be cast anew because of this man, and ended her poem, "Then grant me, Jove, to wear some other shape and be anything except an ape." The narrative thrust of the ensuing strained courtship, the abusive marriage, and the dramatic separation period is also compelling. Lady Byron would always say, Lord Byron suffered more of the ill-fated marriage than she did because he did not love her. I want to emphasize that Lady Byron was a Regency wife as much as the 20th century tried to turn her Victorian. Those in Regency high society didn't generally marry for love. And the fact that Lady Byron did passionately love her husband and soon realized Byron did not love her wouldn't have ended the marriage. Annabella Milbanke vowed before the marriage, and she believed for the rest of her life that she remained Lord Byron's best friend. That Byron didn't love Annabella isn't shocking. That their Regency marriage lasted only a year and 3 days shocked everyone. The incest between Byron and his half-sister, Augusta, as well as the birth of their daughter, Medora, 10 months before Byron married Annabella, was whispered during the separation period. Yet incest had very little to do with the separation. Mainly the cause was Lord Byron's mental cruelty toward Annabella, which dated from the moment she stepped into the wedding carriage on that cold morning on the 2nd of January, 1815. You thought I love you, he said to her, his first words, I'll show you. Cruelty was punctuated by teasing regrets, loving moments, plenty of sex, and then lapse into cruelty. This syndrome of marital abuse is well documented today. That there was no name for it 2 centuries ago doesn't mean it didn't exist. I think the tendency of some scholars to believe that it is always a mistake to use contemporary terminology to describe past action, forget the stubborn consistency of human nature. When Lady Byron was in labor, Byron acted out, making as much noise as possible, going in and telling her mother had died. She hadn't. Going in again and saying, did the infant die? The infant hadn't. And then when seeing Ada for the first time, calling her his instrument of torture. Although Annabella thought to leave since the last stages of pregnancy, she did not. It was Lord Byron who refused to see Ada within 2 weeks of her birth, and then wrote to Lady Byron telling her to take the child and leave as soon as she was able, that he was going abroad. But actually, he stayed at 13 Piccadilly Terrace with his sister after Lady Byron left. Apparently, Lord Byron thought that loving him as she did, Lady Byron would simply, as Annabella's former governess put it, live with the parents, pine for him, quietly raise their daughter, and he would go his own way in Regency fashion. It was only after 24-year-old Annabella swiftly requested a legal separation of bed and board that Byron attempted to win her back. The Regency elite who had championed him previously were now whispering about possible incest as a cause of the rupture. In a short time, sodomy was added to the growing list that painted Byron madder and badder than he wished. To put an end to Annabella seeking a legal separation, Byron employed his glorious words in a rush of seemingly heartfelt love letters, as well as the first poem he ever wrote to her, "Fare thee well, and if forever, still forever, fare thee well." But by then, Annabella's lawyers had educated her. If she responded to Byron's sudden rush of love letters, or to "fare thee well," it would have been what English law of that day called condonation, which meant that the wife had forgiven the husband all previous acts, and the husband could demand her return to his control. As I put it in my biography, if Annabella were living today, she could have taken her time. She might have seen Byron in a neutral setting to talk. She might have had him come to her parents' estate as she first wished to see if they could work things out. She might have had sex with him again. She might have given their life at 13 Piccadilly a second chance. Perhaps Byron would change. In short, Lady Byron would be free to make the mistakes women are free to make today. But she had no such freedom. Doing any one of those things would show she condoned her husband's previous behavior, and legally a wife could be forced back under her abusive husband's control. Lady Byron well knew her husband's beautiful love letters were insincere. As she put it, Byron used words the way his hero Napoleon used his troops for conquest. After much negotiation, bitter back and forth, and dumb luck narrated in my biography, she won a decree. Byron left England as soon as the separation agreement was signed, as by then, fashionable society had turned its back on him, particularly when he walked into Lady Jersey's soiree with his sister on his arm. Yet once aboard ship, sailing from England that he never returned to, he initiated his verbal assault, used his glorious words to restore his honor, and blessed his wife. He presented himself as a bereft father torn from his child, beginning the third canto of Childe Harold's Pilgrimage on Shipboard. "Is thy face like thy mother's, my fair child, Ada, sole daughter of my house and heart?" He told the world of his tenderness as a father. Child, don't forget, this is a child he wouldn't look at and call the instrument of his torture. Wouldn't see after 2 weeks. "To hold thee lightly on a gentle knee, and print on thy soft cheek a parent's kiss. This, it should seem, was not reserved for me, yet this was in my nature." Through all his brilliant poetry, the absent and seductive father Ada would never meet reels his daughter in. Byron became the ghost of a father even while he lived. His elements were hers. He claimed her as he sighed over what might have been. Farewell did turn out to be forever. Byron died in Greece less than a decade later. Lady Byron lived for another 43 years. But what were the next 43 years like? Finding the narrative thrust for Annabella's life after love was certainly the greater challenge in writing this biography. I was convinced from the records that I read at Oxford that Lady Byron's own flaws were not those of lack of love, sexual compatibility, or understanding of her husband, as lovers of Byron's poetry believed. Also, those records show us that she was a committed social progressive and an educational innovator. She was also an abolitionist who helped runaway slaves escape to England, which began her friendship with Harriet Beecher Stowe. And certainly her intelligence was sublime. Just as Byron's friends and later biographers turned her into a demon, her friends tended to turn her into an angel. Neither extreme did her justice. The thing was, she had trouble accepting her dark side. When she felt a great jealousy when Augusta and Byron, his sister, her when they were having a tete-a-tete, and she was sent up to bed early. One night she said, as she wrote down, she said, I knew the his dagger was in the next room. I wanted to plunge it into her heart. But the minute she came up, he sent his sister up to calm her down. That disappeared. But she said she understood then what mental illness would be, that if she ever succumbed to this, she would go insane. And she called her, that she said that she had the gift. She had to have a sense of forgiveness, but it wasn't romantic forgiveness. It was based on what she needed in order to survive. So she was aware of this, but on the other hand, this lack of being psychologically, of being able to accept her dark side, I think, was her major flaw. When a later friend, the great minister, Frederick Robinson, told her to speak out, don't repress yourself, he used the word repress, she wrote to her friend, he said not to repress my feelings, as if one could, if one should, if such an opening would not be a channel for debacle. You know, imagine not repressing your emotions. That's the way she saw it. So there you have it. As Lady Byron herself said, doing good for the poor saved her from herself. No, it wasn't her infant daughter who saved her. While in his poetry, the absent Byron became the perfect father, Annabella, given an infant to raise by herself, was an imperfect single mother, particularly in Ada's early years. In France, they say a woman is either a lover or a mother. The transition from lover to mother took her some time. On Ada's first birthday, she wrote a poem to Ada. Thine is the smile and thine the bloom, where hope and fancy ripen charms. But mine is dyed in memory's bloom. Thou art not in a father's arms. Thou art not in a father's arms. Fidelity was not a necessary component of any Regency marriage, but who of Lady Byron's class was left a single mother? Truly was unheard of. Byron had earlier told the world how he regretted his ability to watch the dawn of little joys as his child grew, quote, to sit and see almost thy very growth, to view thee catch knowledge of objects, wonders yet to thee. Catch knowledge of objects, wonders yet to thee. What wondrous words. The actual catching, as well as any bungling, was left to mom. In the first years of her motherhood, educational innovations for the working class were Lady Byron's salvation. When little Ada was not yet 3 years old, Lady Byron returned from a summer trip to Scotland and founded a museum where she had been raised, the first infant school in England for the young children of the working poor. The school was based on socialist Robert Owen's infant school in Scotland and on the educational values of Swiss Jean-Jacques Rousseau and Henri Pestalozzi. Young children were to learn not through dry book learning imposed by severe masters, but through absorbing the lessons that nature teaches. They were to sing, to dance, to come to love of learning through their own curiosity, inspired by teachers, chosen through their God-given patience and ability to encourage the young toward their own discoveries. The operative word in this progressive education was cheerfulness. Well, just looking at the children's library upstairs, you can see how these ideas, which are just so prevalent, such a beautiful room, that children's library. At the time, you know, it was not like that in the upper class boarding schools at all. In the 1830s, when little daughter Ada was married and the mother herself, Lady Byron had time to once more visit the progressive Popwell School in Switzerland, where she sent her cousins to be educated, and she formed a relationship with its founder, Emanuel de Fellenberg, a follower of Pestalozzi. Returning from Switzerland in her mid-40s, she founded the first cooperative school in England for the education of the older children of the working poor, based on the Swiss plan of, quote, making labor, and more especially agricultural labor, a principal means of education. Part of the young students' day was spent in a pleasant schoolhouse, one she had built for them, the first one, that is, learning through mutual dialogue and respect guided by a humane master. And part of the day was spent out of doors, each tending his garden, his allotment, the healthy produce of which he could give to his family or sell back to his school. She was involved in the allotments from about the 1820s on. In London, in that original cooperative school, there's a blue plaque. It reads, Lady Byron founded the renowned cooperative school there between 1834 and 1850. Today it's the Ealing School of Art, memorable for the 60s music scene. Pete Townsend, Ronnie Wood, and Freddie Mercury were educated there. Apart from the humor of connecting Lady Byron with rock and roll, was she never to escape the bad boys? The plaque stands a rare public acknowledgement of Lady Byron's contribution to progressive education in England. Her progressive ideals were a conscious rebellion against the fagging system and the brutality of the upper class public schools of our country, such as Harrow, where Lord Byron had his first introduction to homosexuality, the English vice, French force. In Lady Byron schools, cooperation, not competition, was emphasized. Children of all or no religion were accepted, and none were forced to attend morning scriptural readings or to go to church on Sunday if they didn't believe. A small fee was to be paid, and on time, it was a token amount, but indicated the school was not a charity, but a partnership. The Bible was not used for classroom instruction. Lady Byron once wrote to a friend, in regards to religious opinions, I am a communist. My neighbor's opinion is as good as mine. If he be right under whatever name, it's so much gain for me. I call this Christian, you do not. Such was the clear reasoning of that liberal, far-seeing benefactor to English education that history is all but ignored. As clear and far-sighted as Lady Byron was when it came to educational advances for the working class in England, her daughter Amy's education was that of many upper-class or aristocratic girls who had intellectual potential. They were educated by tutors at home, just as Lady Byron had been. Lady Byron recognized Ada's intelligence early on. By the time Ada was 2 and a half, she was absorbing information with alacrity. One of the myths about Lady Byron is that she kept Ada from poetry. But in one of the few letters Byron actually not only wrote, but sent to his wife, to his sister naturally, he said that he was glad that Ada was not interested in poetry. Neither had he been as a child. But he hoped that she would learn music and French, and she did both. More than anything, it was science that led Ada on. When Ada was 12, Lady Byron left her with a trusted governess while she spent the winter season in Devon, hoping for a cure to her chronic bronchitis. Ada searched for a way of bringing her letters to her mother and her mother's letters to her more quickly. To this end, she became absorbed in building a flying machine powered by steam. In Don Juan, Lord Byron wrote ironically, steam engines will convey him to the moon. But Ada went beyond metaphor, and after months of single-minded absorption, realized she would base her engine not on a bird's body, but on that of a horse. The steam engine would be carried in its belly. That accomplished, the 12-year-old wrote to her mother that a part of her gear would be, quote, a letter band, a small compass, and a map. We could even call it her GPS. The compass and map, quote, will enable me to cut across the country by the most direct means. Extraordinary attention to details, I think, for a 12-year-old. Lady Byron supported Ada's scientific creativity, but was concerned by the intensity with which her daughter pursued her interests with single-minded preoccupation and limitless confidence in her own ability, bordering actually on the grandiose. She urged the 12-year-old to get on with her other studies as well. Lady Byron was always more psychologically astute when it came to others. She seemed not to understand that her daughter's need for contact with mother was so great that she invented an airplane to fly to her. Ada wrote to her mother, Quote, I wish that supposing I fly well by the time you come back, you would, if you are satisfied with my performance, present me with a crown of laurels. But it must only be on the condition that I fly well. Ada was not only precocious, but headstrong. When her early tutor put her in a corner, she bit off the cornice. She was rebellious like her father. By 16, she was sexually adventurous and had an affair with her tutor. Ada reported they did everything except have connection. Connection or not, they were found out, the tutor fired. Scientifically, she was a prodigy like the Thomasina in Tom Stoppard's play Arcadia, except Ada was more overtly sexual and lived on while Thomasina died. After Ada's affair with her tutor, Lady Byron spent less time with progressive causes and more with royal society and dressmakers preparing a proper course for Ada on the verge of her coming into society. She wrote this in the night after King William IV and Queen Adelaide requested her company. Quote, the king and queen were quite kind to me. However, so many topics could not be brought up in the presence of royalty that she felt the conversation insipid. And quipped that apparently, quote, it is etiquette to stultify oneself, unquote. Still, Ada did turn a corner, didn't bite it off, and came out in London. At this point, her mother brought her to meet the eccentric and brilliant Charles Babbage at one of his quirky and pleasant London soirees. Esteem was the microchip of the 19th century. And it had been Babbage who had the foresight to envision that the steam which powered the railroads connecting England and the factories of Manchester could be capable of powering numbers. A computer in those days was a person. Computing was a cottage industry in which human beings supplied the mathematical tables to be used by navigators and others who needed exact measurements on which to rely. It was said that many French computers were ex-hairdressers who lost their jobs when their clients lost their heads. Human computers, human mistakes. Babbage's steam-powered calculating machine would eliminate human error. Parliament invested heavily in this technological advance, which Babbage named his difference engine. Babbage, a dapper man in his 40s, was interested in everything, and he invited Lady Byron and Ada to a private showing of a small model of the step, the difference engine. If it was completed, it would fill a room, sort of like the first of our tutors. While the rest of the fashionable audience seemed stunned, mother and daughter understood what they were looking at. Babbage was never famous for finishing what he started, and Parliament had already invested £17,000 in the difference engine when he naively told them he had abandoned it for something much more advanced. He was sure they would be pleased to fund his analytical engine, which would be capable of calculating not merely numbers, but information. They never funded him again. By then, Ada was in her early 20s, securely married to an aristocrat, William King, and mother to three children born in quick succession. She was a good friend as well of the older Babbage. Her young and noisy children were a constant distraction to her mathematical studies, and she wrote to her mother, who was in France with her half-sister, Medora Lee, what I consider the ultimate Ada-ism, quote, I wish for heirs. Certainly should never have desired a child. As a result, Lady Byron got busy finding Ada the best advice on Nanny so that Ada could go on with her mathematical investigations. As I said, Ada, since childhood, was never one to underestimate her gifts. All through her life, she had an enduring sense of her fabulousness. Still, now she unselfishly wished to help her older friend Babbage in his quest to procure money because she understood what that analytical machine could be. She translated the Italian Luigi Menabrea's article about the importance of Babbage's analytical engine, and she added notes. The notes turned out to be three times the length of the 24-page article, and there are these notes which are Ada's claim to fame. In them, she wrote prophetically, almost eerily, of how Babbage's analytical engine would be able to calculate information that, quote, it can follow analysis, but has no power of anticipating any analytical relation or truth. Its province is to assist us in making available what we are already acquainted with. Google anyone? Then she went further and included what we would call a software program for the analytical engine in these notes. With the aid of Bernoulli numbers, in 1843, she wrote an algorithm, a variation of which the United States military would use in a program, in its unified program in the 1980s, naming the program ADA, a program still in use and still studied in universities. Babbage used to say he wished he could experience the future only for a half an hour. One can imagine Babbage and Ada walking into the Apple store close by here and rather than reeling about in a confused daze, after adjusting to the small size of the engines, I can hear them both saying, aha. Once Ada's translation and notes were published, she used her computing skills to predict the winners of horse races. To predictable results, she lost a fortune. It was her lover, John Force, who introduced her to the demi-world of gamblers and extortionists. They all convinced her to stay far away from her mother, that Ada was Lord Byron's daughter, someone Lady Byron could never understand. So there's always this poem. I mean, she had this romantic father that she never met, but that wrote beautiful poetry of how he longed for her. And she had this single mother of great intelligence and maybe, you know, not the most empathetic to a daughter in certain ways, but had also a great mathematical skill. I mean, Byron was at first called him his princess of parallelograms. Later he used it satirically, but she, at 19, knew more about science than most anyone of the day, and she knew all these scientists, and she introduced them to all of them. But so she had this almost, I mean, two parts to her nature. But it was Ada's lover, John Cross, who introduced her to the demi-world of gamblers and extortionists. They convinced her to stay far away from her mother, and she did, except when she needed money. And then she would come and she'd tell her mother she needed money for court clothes, for the fine books and music she loved. And there are letters in which she insists that her friends do not tell her mother, when they went out to get more money for her, would not tell her mother what the money was for. Now, since Ada's marriage to William King in 1835 and up to 1850, this is interesting, the same years in which Lady Byron founded cooperative schools, Lady Byron believed she found in her son-in-law, 10 years older than Ada, a father's arm for the daughter she raised. On William King's part, he had never before known mother's love and believed that his mother-in-law's love was unconditional. Lady Byron could not do enough for her high-born, serious crow, as he was called, because of his dark eyebrows. Lady Byron was called the hen, Ada their birdie. It was a barnyard love fest. Shortly after the marriage, it was through Lady Byron's influence that the very young Queen Victoria named William King the first Earl of Lovelace, and Ada became, as we know it today, Ada Countess of Lovelace. When Ada's debts became so huge as to exhaust finances, Lovelace found out about them, and he came to Lady Byron late one night in panic. I don't think if you knew Lady Byron, you came to her late night in panic. She was a woman who isolated herself anyway, and to burst in like that must have been very, very shocking. And he unburdened himself. He said, you know, what was he going to do when he had lost all this money? Rather than consoling him, Lady Byron cried out, didn't he know genius is always a child? How could Lovelace have allowed Ada, with her naivety and her belief in her own infallibility, to go to the races without him? Ada's temper tantrums were always short-lived. He knew that, she said. Why hadn't Ada told her the truth? She said to her son-in-law, quote, I would have given her thousands, just as I gave her hundreds. Did I mention Lady Byron was very wealthy? When Lady Byron refused to see her son-in-law the next morning, Lovelace was stunned. He could not understand that for Lady Byron, her daughter was once more not in the father's arms. Again, she, the single mother, was all alone. Psychologically, to her way of thinking, after all the good she had done for the first Earl of Lovelace, she was once more betrayed. And she wrote, "I am only loved by strangers." Daughter Ada, on her part, wouldn't speak to her mother, saying Lady Byron had insulted her husband. However, Ada stretched the truth to her advantage all the time, and it was more likely she was embarrassed that her mother now knew she had lied to her as she asked for more and more money. No matter, excuse me, Lady Byron got a list of Ada's debts to her lawyer, Dr. Lushington, and paid them all off. Critics have derided Lady Byron, saying, "I would have given Ada thousands, not hundreds," omitting the fact that she actually did. It is almost a given in family relationships that love between mother and daughter often has a critical edge, whereas love between daughter and father seems unconditional. Estranged for a year, mother and daughter reunited in the most tragic of circumstances, where Ada's constantly terrible periods, what she called her black dwarf, were early signs of uterine cancer. During the last half year of Ada's life in 1852, mother and daughter established the intimacy and understanding that had often eluded them. One finds it all portrayed in Lady Byron's unpublished journal letters written during the months that she was with her daughter, night and day. Ada, who once invented a steam engine to fly her letters to her mother, now had her mother all to herself. And perhaps that's what she had needed all of her life. Neither found this out until it was too late. Lady Byron would lament, quote, "to see clearly too late." She couldn't stop thinking, quote, "of what might have been." Yet while she was caregiver to Ada, she did not lament. She was her honest self with Ada. She was always honest. But when her daughter opened her eyes, she always saw her mother's cheerful face. "Can God's love be proved?" Ada asked her mother once after she awoke from a particularly horrible seizure. Lady Byron answered, "Can you prove what I feel for you, Ada? Yet can you disbelieve it?" Lady Byron knew her daughter did not want to be buried at Lovelace Estate in Ockham. By then, Ada informed her husband that his friend John Cross was her lover, and Lady Byron was incensed when Lovelace did not take the news well. The hen had turned into the lioness protecting her cub. Lady Byron thought to comfort Ada by proposing she be buried, as she put it, at Newstead, i.e., by her father in her father's tomb. As she wrote in her journal, "If this causes people to gossip, what could the opinions of the world mean to me?" But when she told Ada that, Ada's face lit up with joy. Quote, Ada told her mother it had already been decided that she would be buried next to her father. But she hadn't told her mother, quote, "because I thought you would be angry at me." Lady Byron, quote, dispelled that entirely. However, quote, "I was secretly wounded by Ada's reserve in not telling me. My journal is not, however, to be feelings of my own away with them." Even in their new intimacy, Lady Byron was still Lady Byron, shooing away her feelings. Ada was still Ada, keeping a secret about wanting to be with her father that might displease her mother. As Ada lied dying at 36, the same age that her father, Lord Byron, died, she said to her mother that she felt regrets at not having done more while she lived. Lady Byron wrote, "I pointed out to her, few thinking minds ever felt their ends accomplished. Yet the survivors have been influenced by those lives in an unforeseen manner, leading us to believe that the ends of our existence are hidden from us." With two words that were spoken, just a few months ago at Oxford University's Department of Computer Science, there was a grand symposium celebrating the 200th anniversary of Ada's birth. And since 2009, Ada Lovelace Day is celebrated every year on the second Tuesday of October. It is a day not only of honoring Ada, computer pioneer, but of all women of science. Who knows but that Ada's half-sister, Majora Lee's Day, might come again as well, though I haven't had time in this talk for what Majora labeled her most strange and dreadful history. For that, I refer you to my biography. Lady Byron's daughters are legion, actually. These women of imagination and intellect who are being rediscovered, reevaluated, and studied seriously on their own merits. Not least of these is Lady Byron herself. Harry Beecher Stowe wrote that through Lady Byron's educational advances and silent philanthropy, Lady Byron did more for England than any other one person of her time. Perhaps Lady Byron's day is coming, for if we listen, she has much to say. Thank you.
Yes, please.
I'm curious about the financial arrangements that Lady Byron was able to make. When she got her legal separation, was she able to reclaim the dowry?
Oh, no, that's an awfully good question. I had quite a lot of this out of my in the marriage, she would receive $20,000 from Byron, but the money was, of course, all in her. The inheritance was going to come from her uncle, who didn't have any legitimate children. When the inheritance came, her uncle hadn't lived long enough to change things, so it went right to Byron. And part of the separation problem, which again, I had a cut of it in the book, one of the problems was generally when this happened, a legal separation was really hard to get. If she had any good lawyers, believe me, don't kill the lawyers first, ladies. Without Washington, she'd still be married. She had this great lawyer who helped her get this, in fact, she's very close to that family, helped her to get this legal separation. Now, generally, when there was a legal separation, out of fairness, the inheritance was, when the mother died, the money was now with Lady Noel, Lady Byron's mother. Out of fairness, that it would be split, half to the man, half to the woman, so that the woman wouldn't be forced back under the control of a husband with whom she was legally separated. Byron fought it for a long time, and it made him less and less appealing in England at that time. But in the end, especially after these whispers of incest and sodomy were going around and other things that are in the book, he said, okay. So when Lady Noel died, and Byron was still alive, that's where he got his money for his Greek expedition. Half of the money, about £4,000 a year, went to Byron, and £4,000 a year went to Lady Byron. And he died pretty soon after that. He died 8 years after the separation. Then all the money came to her. And the next Lord Byron, there's still a Lord Byron, by the way, a really nice guy, but the seventh Lord Byron got nothing but the title, which, Byron left all this, he didn't have much money, but he left it all to his sister. And Lady Byron contributed £2,000 a year, so this new Lord Byron could, maintain the household. So that's the story, I sometimes think that the 19th century, on the highest level, like half the room was here waiting for the other half of the room to die. Work was unheard of. It was like a dirty word among these aristocrats. So everything was a matter. But does that answer the question? That's how the money came.
I have one more.
Sure.
When she endowed all of these wonderful educational institutions, did she use her own capital?
Yes. And the thing was, and she said, during 1848, when all the revolutions were happening through Europe, she said, I dared to be poor.
But she also, her oldest grandson, who was sort of a retrograde named Byron as well, worked on the railroad. As a working man, he wouldn't take a title. And she invested early in the railroads. So though she was really spending all her money and living sparsely in her three estates, she was smart. So was her mother, so was her Aunt Lady Milbanke. They understood financial things, and so the money came. And I think Lord Lytton, the survivor, in her line of family, money could go through the female line, which is very unusual. And it did, right down to the present. I don't think there's much left, but still Lord Lytton inherited, and Lord Byron did. Yes?
You said that Ada had three children?
Yes.
Were they male, female, both? And what went on to happen to them? And you also mentioned a grandchild by the name of Lord Byron?
Yes, that was her grandchild. That was Ada's child. Her first child was named Byron, and her first child was a male. And Lady Byron said, why don't you name him Byron, because otherwise the name is going to disappear. So Byron was the oldest, and he was Lord Ockham. If you want to figure out British aristocracy, it's very difficult to do. I know I can't do it. But anyway, he was Lord Ockham. Then she had a daughter named after Lady Byron, Annabella. And Annabella married Blunt. She became Lady Anne Blunt, and she became one of the first women explorers of the Middle East. And she rode through the Arabian desert on horseback, and she bought the caravan. She saved a certain Arab steed from extinction and brought him back to England. So she was interesting. Then they had the spare, this third child, Ralph. Now, Ralph was raised by Lady Byron. Ada really, when Ada was dying, she realized, how could she have not wanted a daughter? Then, you know, her motherly instincts came out. But Ada was not a very motherly person. I don't think neither was Lady Byron in a certain way, but not as good as Ada. So Lady Byron raised Ralph. He was very smart, but they didn't need him. He was the spare. And he is the one who, after Lady Byron died, who painstakingly collected the records over a period of maybe 20 years, and in the early 20th century brought a lot of the records to light, and all the enormous archives of her, because she never threw anything away. It was bad stuff, she sealed it up, left it for people after her. All this enormous archive that is on loan from Lord Lytton to Oxford is because Ralph saved all those papers.
Yes.
So did Byron marry Annabella for her money? And did she have any whiff of or sense of Byron's relations with his sister before she married Byron?
That's a good question. Not before, because she never met her. The first time she met the sister-in-law was right after the honeymoon. Byron wanted to go to his sister alone, but she insisted on coming. And that's the first time she met Augusta. And then Augusta was still nursing Medora. Later, many years later, she'd write to Ada. She had never seen such a beautiful child. And she was the only person in that household who wasn't miserable. So the strange things went on. Like Byron would have kissing games where they'd have to come over to the couch and Augusta would kiss him, and then Lady Byron would kiss him, and then Lady Byron wrote, I think he kissed her with more passion than he kissed me. I mean, they were young. And so she had an inkling early on. But, you know, I think it's part of the Regency, even though Harriet Beecher Stowe in her book made that the reason. By that time, we're into Victorian society. Lady Byron, that had very little to do. She always thought Medora was just a delightful infant.
Did Byron marry her for her money?
You know, I don't really think so. I think to me, Byron knew nothing about money. All he knew about money college, just keep spending money he doesn't have, not paying bills. I don't think anyone he married would have had money. So I just don't think he would, I mean, it was nice that she had money, but.
So why did she marry
her? The rumors was of this child, Medora, was starting to spread, and it was both, if you read the book, both Augusta, his sister, and Lady Melbourne, Annabella's devious aunt, who pushed him into marriage. And not necessarily her, but in that year, 1814, when people were really gossiping, Annabella refused him 2 years earlier, but then she realized she was in love, and she was the only one who accepted him that year. And it was very reluctant. They hardly knew each other. I think they once touched hands. He kept making excuses not to go to see her and see him. It was really, it's sort of, the more you read about their love letters or whatever they were, the more upsetting they really are. So he was pushed into the marriage, and being who he was, you know, you thought, I loved you, I'll show you, you know, he rebelled against it at the same time. Yeah. It's really interesting. Harriet Beecher Stowe, actually 10 years after Lady Byron died, wrote a book, Lady Byron Vindicated. Harriet Beecher Stowe was much younger than she, but they were corresponding about the slave trade. And Lady Byron was opening a school to fugitive slaves who were coming over. Yes, and when after Uncle Tom's Cabin became like this enormous bestseller through the world, Harriet Beecher Stowe, in about 40, came to Europe for the first time. In fact, she went to Rome, and she went all of it. She was adored, she was idolized. And the one thing she wanted to do was to meet Lady Byron. So they met there, they developed a really great friendship, and then she came back 3 years later, Harriet Beecher Stowe, and again, their friendship developed and developed. And Lady Byron, I told you, toward the end of her life, she was thinking of writing a memoir. She died one day short of her 68th birthday. And she had a lot of these papers collected, if you read the book, you know. And I think she was hinting, because Lady Byron never expressed what she really wanted directly, you know. And she showed them to Harriet Beecher Stowe and said, do you think I should write a memoir? And Harriet Beecher Stowe, after months, said things back to her and said, no, I think you should seal things up and let someone do it after you die. But then, after she died, Byron's Italian mistress, who was by then married to a Frenchman who introduced her as the former mistress of Lord Byron, wrote a book all about how wonderful Lord Byron was. And again, even though Lady Byron was dead, she was vilified. And Harriet Beecher Stowe, I think, felt very guilty. And she got very interested in feminism, and she wrote this book, Lady Byron, Vindicated, and she reproduced the conversation they had in which she had asked Lady Byron if he had had an affair with her sister, and if there had been a child, if she had heard that, and Lady Byron said yes. That was the first time it was in print. And Harriet Beecher Stowe lost her reputation within 2 minutes. The uproar that this woman who was, you know, this Christian woman who had started the Civil War could say such a thing was absolutely appalling to the public. And it's true, she never regained her reputation. Lady Byron, I'm sort of afraid to write this biography. You touch Lady Byron, you get burnt. Yeah.
Inherited
the money, and he was going to go and fight the independence of Greece, having, you know, gotten great costumes for the soldiers and getting to Greece. And he died of fever before he ever saw battle.
So she lived 35 more years.
Yeah. property as our vote.
No.
Any other questions? Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.